Bible yesterday is coming from Matthew, 18th chapter, 3rd to the 9th verse. I ask that you go there and follow along with me so you can understand where I'm coming from. Like I said, our key verse is, whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this little child, the same is greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Our lesson today is asking the question, who's the goat? Who's the goat? When you think of a goat, I'm not talking about that farm animal that you think of when you say goat. When I think of who's the goat, I think of the human form of people saying, who is the greatest of all times? Who is the greatest of all times? You know, sports people, the humans are asking that question every day. Who is the great? Who is the goat? Who is the greatest? And from being the goat, you get certain prestige. You get certain perks. Not born. It says that you're the greatest. And we as Christians have that same attitude sometimes. We want to become find out who's the greatest. Yeah. We can't just serve God for what we're doing, but for the purpose that we love Him. So we have to think about who's the greatest. Sometimes we even go forward and say, who's the greatest? Just because they think people are the greatest because they got the biggest mega church, and they got the mega this and all that. But in today's lesson, it asks the person, the disciples. This is God's chosen people, His disciples. It tells in the lesson today that the disciples at this time had been arguing among themselves on who was the greatest in God's kingdom. And to tell you this, they even had the nerve once before to ask God who's going to sit on the right side. So in this lesson today, comes down and opens up with Matthew 18, chapter 3, verse. It said, at the same time came the disciples unto Jesus, saying, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Now, when the disciples asked this question, they weren't thinking about God's kingdom. They were thinking about a kingdom as a human kingdom. That God would take over. When they came, that Jesus, they came right then to take over. Form His kingdom. And if He formed the kingdom, as a ruler, you had people under you who had one in this little less position and this one a little less position. And so they were arguing about who was going to be, who was the greatest, who was going to be his right hand man, who's going to be there on his right side. And so they asked the question, who is the greatest in your kingdom? Now, in Jesus, was very smart. He answered them in a way that he gave them an answer in a way that perplexed them. Because he showed them that his kingdom was not, greatness was not measured in the way that we measure greatness here on earth and worldly greatness. We're going to go further. We're going to talk about the same. The disciples assumed that being the greatest would give them a position of prestige and success and honor. They believed that Jesus would definitely define greatness in the matter considered to the world's assumptions. Do you see worldly measures of success? Prestige so that you might be great in the world expectation? Or instead, can you practice faithful and humble service to God? Okay, as I was saying, they asked who's the greatest. And Jesus knowing, some of the disciples figured he was going to name either Peter, day of the judgment, because they had seen Jesus in his transfiguration. And so they got in, they was arguing about who was the greatest. And so they finally got up in their church and they asked Jesus, who's the greatest? He gave them. And Jesus, instead of answering it in the way that they expected, he gave them an illustration. In Matthew, the second, 18th chapter, the second verse, it said that Jesus called a little child unto him and set him in the midst of them. And Jesus did not answer the disciples' question directly. Instead, he used an illustration to show them that he did not measure greatness in the way that an earthly way. This teaching method was to let them know that what they thought was greatness and position was not true. The greatest position, he said, in his kingdom would be that of a little child. Okay, they go on down to the next verse, the third verse, and they said, "Verily I say unto you, except you be converted." Okay, now this converting, this conversion that he's talking about here is not the conversion when you're born again and being saved, but this conversion is when you're born again away from your sin and turn, change your attitude when you become like a little child. Jesus picked a little child and put him there for a purpose. He said, because a child have a humble attitude. They have to depend on somebody else for all their things, for everything. And so, Jesus was trying to tell his disciples, until you change and become converted, you will never even enter into the kingdom of heaven. Now, can you imagine how his disciples felt? They've been here with him all this time, went through all these sacrifices, and he tell them, okay, you know, unless you become converted, what do you mean to become converted? I've been with you all this time. I'm expecting. I've been doing all this for you. I gave up all this for you. What? You mean I'm not gonna get this great reward? And Jesus say, "Verily I say unto you, unless you accept, you be converted." But he meant become. He asked the first thing, he said, "Well, can we become a child again?" And then Jesus don't know, but you can be converted. Your mind can change to become a mind of a like it's a, not to think as a child, but to have the attitude of a child. To become dependent on me. To understand that I will provide you everything that you need. You don't need prestige. You don't need positions. In the fourth, it said, "And becoming like a child, ye shall not enter." And become like a child, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Now, can you imagine being told that you can't? You had to worry about jockeying for a position. And he's telling you, unless you change your attitude and change your way, you're not even going to enter into the kingdom of heaven. You know, many of us as Christians today have looked at it with the same attitude. We do what we come to church and we do things for position, for prestige, to be seen. God wants us to know that he wants us to serve him in a humble way. He said, Jesus came when God sent Jesus to earth. He humbled himself and he became a servant. So we as Christians have got to become servants. We've got to humble ourselves. We got to serve people. We got to. Jesus served him, humbled himself so that he would die. He would die. I would say, we've got to become the same way. We've got to do the same thing. We've got to become like the little child. He said, and whosoever therefore shall humble himself like this little child, the same is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. So what he was telling them, now he don't judge greatness as we judge on earth judge greatness. He judged greatness by humbling and depending on him. That's what God wants us to do. He's demonstrated his life of humbling during his time on earth. He even went so far as to die on the cross for our sin. We as followers of Jesus must humbly live a life and consider a great to others to be greatness in the kingdom of heaven. You know, it says that we can learn a lot from a child. You know, say, when we was a child, he said, not think like a child, but be humble like a child. He said, a child depends, has a total dependence on everybody. He said, but a child, even as a child, he said, a child first thing, he gets earthly things, he gets to thinking what he wants to do as he gets older. And if you think back when you was a child, there was some great thing that you wanted to do that you felt you couldn't wait to do. When you get older, he said, we've got to become like that towards God and His work. We have got to give what we can't wait to do God's work. He said, God looks at children and us as His children, as a church, and He thinks about the greatness. He said, think about your grandchildren or your children. And how great they make you feel when they're born and when they do things that honor you and please you. He said, God wants us as His children to serve Him in the same manner. Bring it honor to Him. And he goes on down to verse 5, he said, whosoever shall receive one such little child in my name, receives me. So it's saying that God, when we receive a child and start to think and act like a child and we humble ourselves and act like a child, then that's when it shows we're receiving God. And that's how we show greatness in the kingdom of heaven. It's not about great things. It ain't that we went out and built the biggest mega church. It's not that we preached every Sunday. It's not that we went to church every Sunday. But it's that we humbled ourselves and became servants to everyone. You know, we look at the person that got the big mega church, he got the big planes and all this stuff. We look at greatness on an earthly form. But God said, you can never measure greatness in His kingdom that way. He said, because all of us have what He gave us. He said, there's no big person in His kingdom. And He goes on to say, the one of sins of person, He said, but who shall ever offend one of these little ones will be who believes in me. He said, he's warning there about you offending your children, little children. He goes on to say it would be better for the men to have placed a millstone around that, above that shoulder and tossed into the river. That the men are hurt a little child. Blessing goes on to talk about greatness and says, he asks the question, do you measure your work that you do for Christ as greatness? those people at the same time and another deserve to have power and be seen and great in the world. But we as Christians must live in a different manner. Our greatness is not shown by our possession of what we have in the world. Greatness by the Christian standard is not measured by that of the world. God requires believers to depend on Him and trust in His teaching and depend on Him for His greatness. Through His power and Holy Spirit, Father Jesus must learn to embrace Jesus in the position of greatness. We must understand that we must accept Jesus' form of greatness to enter into His kingdom, to be great in His kingdom. He said, furthermore, followers of Jesus must remove foreign worldly things from them, from themselves, so that they can remove the sin of self-praise from themselves. You know, he's saying that when you start praising yourself for what you've done, then you said God wants us to do what we do for Him humbly because we love Him. Because He's done so much for us. He said, we should use Jesus as an example of the way that we should live our lives. Followers of Jesus must embrace an attitude of humility and trust. This is not a human nature that goes along with the world, but God will provide you with the things that you need if you follow Him and trust in Him, and He will make you great. When we embrace the attitude, we will likely not receive worldly glory, but instead we will share in the promise and the superior glory of God's kingdom. It was that similar to say, when we humble ourselves and follow and just praise God and trust in God, glory, that He assures greatness and don't depend on the worldly greatness. Because God's way is not of greatness, it's not the world's way of greatness. See, we get tied up on possessions. We think because we got big stuff, we're great. It says that the true greatness results from a life of humility and self-control. It says you can't be out of control doing any kind of thing, worldly thing, and be considered great in God's kingdom. See, because when God example that He showed of the child and didn't answer the question. He didn't answer the question outright. So, could you imagine what would have happened if He'd have picked one of them? Even though it's his kingdom, he could have put anybody he wanted as the greatest in His kingdom. But could you imagine what would happen to the other 11 disciples, if He said one was greater than the other one? How would you feel if you were working in the church doing all your work and someone gives someone else praise for their work and don't praise you for your work? So God said, I honor your work, but I honor it because of why you did your work. He said, because if you did your work to receive praise, He said, then, your work was in vain. He said, but if you did your work to honor me and give me glory, even if nobody else says anything on earth about you, He said, then I'll praise you. I give you the honor and praise glory as you deserve. He said, but we as Christians look for the wrong thing, for the wrong honor. We look for honor in the wrong places. We look for folks to give us power, honor, and glory. He said, but he promised us if we serve him and become thy child and stuff, that he would be the one that would give us honor and glory. He said, true greatness results from a life of humility and self-service. Have you ever thought about it? So when you think about being great, think about humility and self-service. That's the true honor of greatness. It ain't what you're going to receive out of it. It ain't what you get out of it. It's because you've already got enough. God gave you enough. Already. But his greatness, your greatness will be honored through him. So if you don't get anything up out of this lesson, remember that true greatness comes from service and humility. Our next lesson is going to be coming from kind of our next lesson is talking.